Sumner, and I'm the Assistant Director of Enrollment Services here at the Louisiana School. And today I'm going to be doing the presentation that I would normally do as I travel around the state to talk to families and prospective students. But because of the situation we have right now, we don't really want to travel or gather in large groups, so we're going to present this to you virtually. So I'm going to give you my presentation. It's going to take me somewhere around an hour, but I promise to try to go as quickly as I can. But I also want to make sure that we cover a lot of different things. So you can see the list here to my left. We're going to go over all of these topics today. But first, I actually want to show you a few things that I'm not even going to get into. And the reason I'm going to do that is because each one of these things I could talk about for 5-10 minutes each. And I just want to make sure that we kind of go as quickly as we can to get you some of the basics. We'll do other videos on these topics. And if you have any questions, always feel free to contact us. But for right now, we're just going to go ahead and dive into the rest of the material. So I'm going to go ahead and hop off the screen. And we're going to start off by talking about student life. And whenever I talk about student life, I always like to divide it up into these three categories. Just first of all, living in the residence hall. That's going to be the biggest adjustment for a student who's starting here at the Louisiana School. And so we're going to talk about living there. We're going to talk about some of the extracurricular activities and just some of the different things involved in student life. So in the residence hall, the first thing I like to talk about are student life advisors, or SLAs. Our SLAs do a lot of different things for our students. The most important thing to know is they're going to serve as an intermediary, first between the student and the parent. So if you haven't been able to get a hold of your child, maybe they're not answering phone calls or text messages, that SLA is somebody who can go walk down the hall and talk to your student. Also between the student and the teacher, I can't tell you how many times I had a teacher ask me for who someone's SLA is, because they wanted to let them know that that student seemed to be having a bad day. And then also even between the teacher and the parent, obviously you're not here, and so if you want somebody to go and talk face-to-face, make that connection, or just to help you make connection, that's somebody who can do that for you as well. Outside of that, they do a lot of fun things. So you can see arts and crafts, movie nights, video game tournaments, and of course the most popular one is always going to be food. So some of our SLAs are quite the accomplished chefs, and they'll cook for their residents, they'll do some different programs with food, and it's just a good chance to kind of get away from some of the academic stuff for a little bit, take a break, enjoy yourself with your neighbors, and kind of hang out in your hall. As for the residence halls themselves, we're actually opening up our new residence hall in the fall of 2021, and so you can see here on the screen I've got a blueprint of what that new building is going to look like. The picture to the right side of the screen, that's going to be a blueprint of each suite. So every student is going to live in a 4-person, 2-bedroom suite. They'll have a roommate, they'll have a pair of suite mates, those four will share that suite. And you can see they have their own private restroom, and then each one will have their own bed, desk, and dresser combo inside of the room itself. This is all going to be in one building, but there will be security doors and guards that are on duty at all times, so students aren't going to be able to go on halls that they shouldn't be on. And then it's also going to have a lot of our common spaces, so study rooms, game rooms, lounges, the nurse's office will be down there, a lot of different things are going to be available to our students. Another great thing about the Louisiana School is that we have over 50 clubs and organizations. Yes, that's 50 as in 50. That's great for two reasons. One of them is I know some students who are watching this video now may already be thinking about college applications, and the fact that we have so many different clubs means you're going to have a lot of different opportunities to get involved, a lot of different leadership opportunities. So you may be the president of one club and the vice president of another. So there's going to be a lot of different ways to get involved in the school community. Another great thing about having so many clubs, as you can see from the pictures on the screen, is that there's going to be a lot of different areas of interest. And so for our students, especially new students who are maybe working on finding people with common interests and new things, you're going to have a lot of opportunities to get involved and to find something that's a good fit for you. And we always tell people, if there's something that you want to have a club for and we don't have it, you can start one. We have new clubs forming all of the time, old clubs will start to fade out. It really just kind of goes based on student interest. So if there's something that you're passionate about, you're going to be able to make that club happen. We also do a lot of school-sponsored activities. So again, just in the interest of kind of getting outside of the classroom and enjoying being a student and being a teenager. So just some of the ones I have pictured here, you can see the outdoors club eating on a hike one day. In the top right corner, you can see a picture of our students getting ready for the Christmas Fest parade, which is one of the biggest things that we do here in Natchitoches all year long. In the bottom left, you can see a couple of our students who volunteer with the Natchitoches Humane Society, and they're helping out at a pet washing day. So there's a lot of different things you can do both in the school and in the community to get involved. Our students still have a lot of opportunity for competitions as well. And so I've got a couple of pictures here. The two on the left are from some of our students who competed at FBLA. And we had some students who even did really well at the state level and got to go to nationals. And on the right, I've got a picture of the math club who went to a college math competition and placed. And so you can see a couple of students holding checks. And then the chess club getting together and playing against each other. Now, no presentation about the school will be complete without talking a little bit about our athletic opportunities. And there's a few different ways that you can get involved in sports. If you want to play any of the sports that we offer, you can see the eight listed there at the top of the screen. All you have to do is come out and tell the coach that you want to play. That's it. That's the tryout. You're on the team. Now, with that being said, we do play to win. And so if you've never touched a volleyball before, you might not get a lot of playing time at first. But I can't tell you how many times I've seen people who have never really played, and then by the time they graduate, they were one of our best players. So if that's something you're interested in, that's great. Come along and join us. You also have the opportunity to play sports at either Natchitoches Central or St. Mary's. So Natchitoches Central is a 5A school and St. Mary's is a 1A. And you can do a lot of different things there. You can try out for their basketball teams, their soccer teams. Whatever your interest is, you can look into doing that. Every year we have students who compete in a variety of sports. A lot of soccer players go and join the Natchitoches Central soccer team. We have a lot of students who choose to run cross country. So just kind of depending on your interests, whatever you want to do, you're going to have those opportunities. And no athletic conversation would be complete without talking about SLANT. SLANT is an acronym. It stands for the Schools of Louisiana, Arkansas, sometimes Alabama, Mississippi, and Texas. And Mississippi doesn't come anymore, but SLANT sounds better than SLAT, so we kept that in there. And so as you can see from the picture on the screen, what this is, it's a team sport decathlon of sorts. And so every year we get together with sister schools like the Arkansas School for Math, Science, and the Arts, or the Texas Academy for Mathematics and Science, and we play them in a bunch of different sports. And it's really cool because it's a chance to get together and get to know other people who might be interested in the same things that you are. So I tell people all the time, one of the coolest things about coming to LSMSA is that you're going to meet people from different parts of the state and realize just how different their life has been, but you also ended up making the same decision to come to the Louisiana school, to leave home early because you wanted to pursue a higher education. And so whenever we do these tournaments, what you do is you meet even more people like that. So we'll meet people from northern Arkansas or west Texas who come from just vastly different backgrounds, but at the end of the day, they wanted to make the same decision that our students made. And so it's really neat to kind of get to network, get to know other people. Every year at this, I always hear that, you know, some students end up becoming roommates in college with somebody they met at this tournament. So it's a really cool opportunity to get to know other students with similar interests. So now we're going to talk about the campus. While the Louisiana School is located on the campus of Northwestern State University in Natchitoches, we have our own nook. So you can see on the screen right there, those are our three main academic buildings, and then our gym is just behind the high school building to the left. So all of our buildings are very much compacted right here. The new residence halls are going to be built right to the back right of this picture, so all of that's going to be right in one space. The high school building is probably our most well-known building. It's what we use in a lot of our advertisements. It's a beautiful old building, and there's a lot of different things that happen in there. So, for instance, the third floor is where all of our science classes, lectures, and labs take place. Our second floor has a variety of things. It's going to have your literature classes, some math courses. It has our college counseling center. Our foundation is located there. So there's a lot of different things going on the second floor. And the first floor is going to be mostly offices. So if you wanted to visit with your teachers, talk to somebody in enrollment services, the director, all of those offices are on that first floor. And then connected to this is also the dance studio. It's in the back side of the building on the second floor. And so that's where our dance courses, yoga classes, and other courses like that are held. The next building is the Music and Art Building, or the MAB. And so this building is really neat to get to walk through. The first floor houses all of our visual arts classrooms. So you'll see ceramics, you'll see digital media, drawing and painting. All of those courses are held down there, and it's filled with student artwork. So it's a really fun hallway to get to walk down. And then the second floor is where all of our music classes are held. So whether you're doing piano, other instrumentation, if you're doing voice, chorale, all of those are going to be held up on the second floor. So you'll find that we have some private practice rooms, a group practice room, a keyboard lab, and teachers' offices all located up on that second floor. After that is the CPT, or the Center for Performance and Technology. Again, this building has a lot of things going on in it. So that first floor is going to be mostly comprised of the cafeteria. If you see through the arches in that picture there, those windows, that's the cafeteria. But also on that first floor is a lot of our performance spaces. So we have the art gallery where our students and professional artists will exhibit their art throughout the year. We've got a recital hall where we'll have some of our smaller musical performances, especially like senior recitals. And then we also have the Black Box Theater, which is where we'll do some of our smaller plays and performances. On the second floor is where you're going to find our computer lab. So it's going to be where most of our technology courses are held. It's going to be where the student mailboxes are. And we're going to have a lot of other study spaces, the Student Success Center, rooms that our students can take advantage of to get a quiet place to study, to get some work done, or to work in a group. And then our last academic building is the gym. So I mentioned earlier that we do have our own sports teams, but we also have our own gym. So we're not sharing with the community or Northwestern. This is very much our own place. If you walked in, you would see the LSMSA Eagles logos on the floor, on the walls. So this is our space. So outside of having practices in here, we also have a lot of our health and PE courses. And that's really cool because PE at the Louisiana School isn't just PE. It's classes like weight training or self-defense and boxing, which is taught by a couple of sheriff's deputies. Some of our dance courses will count as PE credits, or you could even do yoga. So there's going to be a lot of different opportunities to try out different things in that building. And then finally, you can see our green spaces. So on the left is our courtyard, and you can see it's got like our life-size chessboard. It's got a lot of benches and kind of open spaces. So this area in particular, you'll see like a lot of classes are being held if it's a nice day, especially discussion-heavy classes where they don't need to do a lot of writing. So maybe like a literature class where they're discussing the reading, maybe a foreign language class. If it's a nice day, they'll go outside and have class outside. On the right is a picture of our quad. Again, this is the space between our three main academic buildings. And you can see on a typical day, you'll see students hanging out in the grass, just enjoying some sunshine, maybe studying on one of the benches. Maybe they got some ice cream to go from the cafeteria, so eating their ice cream cone outside. It's just a nice space to kind of hang out and enjoy some good weather. So now we'll get into the academics. I always love to start off by talking about our faculty because I think that's one of the things that makes us the most unique. They were ranked the number 3 high school faculty in the nation by niche.com for 2019. And there are a few factors that go into that decision. One of them is the qualifications of our teachers. Over 3/4 of our teachers have a PhD or another terminal degree in their field. Half of our teachers have been here for at least a decade. And that number used to be even bigger. But very recently, we had people retire who were here from the very start of the school's existence, which was back in 1983. And so that's an important factor because I tell people all the time, you know, students have probably had some of their favorite teachers leave their school. You know, teachers may always be looking for something else. They might be looking for different hours. They want to work at a different level. Our teachers love it here. They love what they do. There's a few reasons for that. One of the things is our class size is 12 students on average. Our bigger classes are 18, but you may get into some classes that only have 5 or 6. So our teachers are extremely knowledgeable in their field, and then they're teaching a really small class size of students who took the chance on leaving home early. You know, they came to the Louisiana school, they left their home, moved into residence halls, because they wanted to pursue a higher education. So they're going to be great students. So our teachers love getting to teach to them, which makes our students love learning from them. And it kind of creates this great feedback loop where everyone has a really great time because they're loving what they get to do here. The classes themselves are taught at a college level. They're taught out of college textbooks. They even meet like college classes do, you know, either Monday, Wednesday, or Friday, or Tuesday, Thursday. So it's just like being in a college classroom. In fact, the classes that we offer, you're going to find more often these are college classes than you would find them in a high school. So these are just some of our higher level course offerings. These aren't necessarily classes that you have to take. So if you're not a big math person, you don't have to take chaos theory. But it's just nice to be able to see, you know, I always tell people if there's a subject that you're passionate about, you're going to have the opportunity to dive in. So just as an example, if you look at the history classes, you know, most courses in Louisiana, you're going to follow the same 4 classes no matter what school you go to. But here at the Louisiana School, you can get into Abrahamic faiths, Tudor Stuart England. There's a whole class on Franklin Roosevelt. There's a whole class on gender studies. So there's just a lot of different opportunities, a lot of different things that our students can get into. The other side of that is if you've just always wanted to try something, we're going to have a really wide variety of classes that you can take as an elective. So if you want to learn more foreign languages, you know, we've got Chinese or ancient Greek, we've got Arabic. If you've always wanted to try to learn more about computers, you can get into data structures or video game design. We have robotics classes, just so many different things that you can try out. The art classes there on the right, again, there's so much more than just your standard art courses. You can get into really specific things, and there's just a lot of different opportunities to be involved in that program as well. And I really quickly just want to talk about our College Counseling Center. It's one of the main things that I like to talk about if you're trying to decide if this is a good opportunity, if this is something that you want to pursue. Our College Counseling Center does a great job with working with our students to help them look into, you know, what kind of college do you want to go to, but also, you know, not just what's your dream school, but what are some other schools? What schools are going to have the programs that you're the most interested in? They do a lot of different things. So like at the bottom, you can see, you know, our students get accepted into a lot of great schools every year, and we're incredibly proud of them, and that is awesome. And you know, these students are so successful. But we also like to stress, you know, that's not the only way to be successful from coming through the Louisiana school. We have some students who stay here in Natchitoches every year and they go to Northwestern State University. And those students usually start as juniors, and so they finish in 2 or 3 years. And they finish with no debt. And that is also a really awesome way to be successful. So there's a lot of different opportunities to kind of put yourself into a good position here at the Louisiana school. The college counselors help our students apply for scholarships and look into different scholarships. So you can see the class of 2019, which was 113 students, had over $36 million in merit-based scholarships. Merit-based means I earned that. And so you can see there, that's an average of around $320,000 per student. Now, in all fairness, they're not claiming every penny of that. Because, you know, they might have one school offers them $40,000 a year and another school offers $20,000, and so they're having to kind of pick and choose. But what you see that creating is options, right? So you can decide, do I want to go to my dream school and pay a little bit more? Do I want to go to this school and maybe have a full ride? So there's a lot of different opportunities that's going to open up for our students. As for our foundation, they do a lot of really great things as well. It's headed by our new executive director, Ms. Allie Landry. And the foundation handles a few different things. One of their primary roles is they are a fundraising branch of our school, and so they help bring in money that pays for new materials, new desks and classrooms, new textbooks. Whenever our teachers do some professional development, they'll help pay for that. And they help pay for a lot of things for the students as well. So the foundation does a really great job of helping meet the needs between, you know, what the state budget provides for us and what we want to be able to do. And so they kind of help bridge that gap. They also are over the Parents Council. And so you can see in the top right corner, that's our version of your typical PTA. And so, you know, for the parents out there who have always been a part of a classroom experience, you know, if you've maybe been a room mother or you help out with your student school, you're still going to have those opportunities. And the people who are pictured there serving food, most of them aren't local. Those are people who came from all over the state to help out for one of our big events. And people can choose to help out any way they want to, either by providing some time, providing goods, services. Our Parents Council does a really great job being involved, even though their students aren't living at home anymore. Then we also have the Alumni Association. And so that's a way for our students to stay connected. They do a lot of different things throughout the year. One of the more fun ones is they'll do a tailgate every year at an LSU game. So the picture I have chosen here, that's actually from the LSU-Texas game from 2019. But they do a tailgate every year. It's an opportunity for students to kind of get together. And it's really cool because you'll have alumni who graduated back in the 80s interacting with alumni who graduated in 2018 or 19. And so people are getting to know each other. It's kind of a good networking opportunity. And so it's just really cool for us to kind of bridge that gap between generations and get to know each other. So finally, kind of getting into what's next and where you're going to go from here, we're going to talk a little bit about the application. So the packet itself, what we're looking for whenever you fill out your questionnaire is depth of response. So you don't need to write an entire essay to answer every question, but you do want to make sure that you give us a good sense of who you are in your presentation. I'm going to talk about 2 and 4 together, so we'll come back to those. For the LEAPS and EOC test results, that's only if you've been to public school. A lot of our students have been who came up through a private school program and they don't have that, that's perfectly okay. The main reason we use these is it's really helpful, especially maybe if you don't do as well as you wanted to on your ACT, but you have a really strong test background with your LEAP scores, then we know that when you've learned the material, you learn it really well. And so this is just a thing that can help boost your application. As for the letters of recommendation, we ask for at least three, and these three specifically, and then you're always welcome to get some additional ones if you'd like to. So your English teacher and your math teacher, we want that to either be people who are teaching you this school year or last school year. We understand some students are on block schedule, you might not have had an English teacher, you know, this semester. So if you want to go back one year, you can do that. We ask that you don't go back any further than that. You know, it's great if your fourth grade math teacher was a really big fan of yours, but that probably doesn't tell us a whole lot about how ready you are to jump into accelerated college algebra. So for the teachers, to keep them relatively recent. As for the guidance counselor or school administrator recommendation, that one needs to be from the school that you're at right now. And so, you know, I always kind of explain it to people. English and math are real references. The guidance counselor, school administrator, it's almost kind of like a background check and a job application. It's less important that they know you on a personal level and more that they have access to, you know, if there are any discipline issues that we need to be made aware of, any attendance issues that we need to be made aware of. So they don't have to have as close of a personal relationship with you. So now I'm going to talk about numbers 2 and 4. The numbers I have on the screen for those are because some people will demand numbers, right? They want to know, what do I need to do to get in? So we've created some just because some people really want that, but also understand that these aren't hard numbers and these aren't firm bottom lines. For instance, a GPA of 3.5 or above, our average incoming GPA is a 3.9. So yes, you know, you have some wiggle room, but the better your grades are, the better your chances of getting in. And we're also going to unweight that GPA when we evaluate the GPA. So, you know, if you have, if you have a B in all of your honors classes, you know, some schools will tell you that's still a 4.0. We're going to look at that as a 3.0. So just kind of be aware of that. And then as for the ACT, again, these are just numbers that we put out there. Those are targets to aim for, but they are by no means numbers that you absolutely must hit. You know, every year we have students who come in 1 or 2 points below their grade level. Sometimes we even have students who come in 3 or 4 points, but you know, their teachers say such great things about them and their grade history is stellar and maybe their LEAPs have been really good as well. So, you know, we still want students like that. You know, I tell people all the time, I would rather have a student who's coming in as a sophomore with a 20 on their ACT and a 4.0 and glowing teacher recommendations than a student coming in as a sophomore with a 29 on their ACT and a 3.6 GPA whose teachers say, well, they don't turn in their work or they're lazy. Because, you know, we hear all the time, oh, well, I just haven't been challenged. Well, still, getting your work done is a sign of maturity, and being mature is really important here because you're going to be a lot more on your own than you're used to. And if you lack the maturity to get things done now, how are you going to handle it whenever you're only responsible for yourself? So again, these aren't firm numbers. The review council that looks at every application, you know, they really take a lot of different things into consideration. So you don't need to stress on these or focus on these alone. You know, we really want to look at the entire student, but these are some good numbers to aim for. I have a timeline, just some different things to be aware of through our application season. So our applications are already open. They open usually right after Labor Day weekend. Right now we're starting some videos and webinars and different things that you can watch to learn more about the school, since we're not going to be able to have tours, at least not in the fall, and maybe in the spring, we'll have to see. We do have a couple of tentative exploration dates lined up. Again, that's going to depend a lot on where our student is at, what phase we're in as we recover from this COVID-19 pandemic. So if you want to come to a group tour, hopefully we'll be able to have something, but we won't know more about that until we get closer to it. We'll start reviewing applications in January, and so we'll start accepting students late January, early February. And from that point on, we have what we call rolling admissions. So as students' files are completed, we'll schedule an interview with them. We like to talk to all of our applicants before deciding. And then usually within 3 or 4 weeks, students will have their decision. So that April 1st priority deadline, it's not a firm deadline, but what happens is spaces that we have for our next school year, we have to have a waiting list. So if you get done before April 1st and you meet the requirements, we can guarantee you a spot. After April 1st, you may end up on a waiting list, and then that's a whole different process to work through. Our orientations are the last weekend in May. So right now, again, if we can meet in person, that's when we're going to have our new student orientation. If not, we'll consider some other opportunities, and then students move in for their school year in August. We still encourage people to visit us. We're not requiring it this year like we do in most years. We understand that, you know, there's a lot going on in the world. It's not necessarily going to be easy to come in and set up a tour. So if you can't do it, that's all right. But it's really the best way to get a feel for what campus is like. So we're doing private tours all fall, but you can look at coming in and doing a group tour in the spring if we have those. But again, we're really happy to set up private tours. I recommend trying to come on either a Monday or Tuesday right now. I know it's not possible for everyone to come on a work day, but on those days, we still have teachers in the classrooms, you know, teaching to their Zoom class. And so that's the best chance to maybe get to interact with some different people and get to know some of our teachers while you visit. Definitely keep in touch. I've got a digital copy of my business card here. So if you want any of my information, feel free to take a screenshot or to write that down. I also have a couple of school social media accounts. So if you're more comfortable that way, if you want to send a direct message, you can do that as well. I'm happy to get back to you on those. I might be a little slower, but you know, email, phone calls, social media, whatever works best for you. Please send me any questions that you have. Don't feel bad. Don't think that any of them are silly. We want to make sure to answer every question. We want to help you get as much information as you need to make this decision for you and your family. So we're getting close to the end, so a couple of parting thoughts. You know, why choose the school? I mentioned when I said, you know, some students stay here in state and can start their college classes as juniors. You know, we have an articulation agreement with almost a dozen different universities, and so students can start all the way up with 74 hours of credit. Some of our students get associate's degrees even before they graduate here from doing dual enrollment. So there's a lot of different ways to kind of start building up that transcript and saving any amount of time and money on your undergraduate work, especially if you want to go into grad school, med school, whatever. That's going to be a huge help to you financially. No matter what your school has to offer, and there are great schools. You know, I hate to sound sometimes like I maybe say, oh, we have this and they don't, but the things that we have, most schools can't offer. They just don't have the resources. You know, they don't have teachers with PhDs in genetics or medieval European history. They don't have the facilities to do a lab class every single week. And so we're going to have things that you're just not going to be able to find anywhere else. Our students also have a lot of say in their education. A couple of years ago, we had some students who took organic chemistry and said, hey, we'd love to take inorganic chemistry. And they approached a teacher and he said, if you can find at least 6 students who want to take it, then I'll teach you that class. So those students helped create a class. So you're going to have more say in your education than you've ever had before. You're also going to get prepared for college in a variety of ways. Some of them are going to be pretty obvious, right? You're going to be used to doing some of that college level classwork. You're going to be used to having a roommate. You're going to be used to kind of setting your own time. All of that stuff, probably fairly obvious. There are some that aren't as obvious. I always like to tell people, when you get to college, you'll be your advisor's favorite student because you'll be used to planning out your schedule. So I'll leave you with a couple of final thoughts. The first one is to just not be intimidated. You know, I know sometimes I go through this presentation and you see how great our students have done on the ACT, or you see all those really scary looking classes and think, oh, that's so high level. There's really nothing to be intimidated about. We have students every year. We have some students who are just really, really bright and they do really well. We also have some students who have to work really hard. But if you have that work ethic, if you put in time with your teachers and you go to office hours and you put in the work, you can be successful here. So don't let those intimidating looking options frighten you. If this is something that you want, you should absolutely pursue it. And the other thing that I haven't mentioned, I have a very specific reason for that, you might have noticed. I don't like to talk about money, because the point of this presentation is to help you and your family decide if this school is going to be a good fit for your student. And money should not play a role in that. You know, I talked about our foundation, they do such a great job raising funds. If the cost of attendance is an issue for your family, you can apply for a fee waiver. The foundation can help you out. There are so many different things that we'll do. So please, please, please never let money be a factor for you, because we won't let that stand in the way of somebody who wants and deserves to be here. So there, that being said, there is some cost of attending. That average cost is about $1,400 a school year. So that gets you from August to May. That covers living in our residence hall. That covers eating your meals. And I'll tell you right now, Papa Sumner couldn't have fed me for $1,400 a year. That covers textbooks. If you, anyone out there has paid for college textbooks, you know how expensive that can be. Those are covered as well. It even covers things like our publications, like the newspaper, the yearbook. All of that is covered in that $1,400. But again, if that's going to be any sort of a problem, let us know. We'll get you a fee waiver form. The foundation will help. We're going to make sure that that doesn't become an issue for you. And that concludes our presentation. If you want to learn more about the school, please feel free to check out our video series on LSMSA in 5 minutes or less, airing new episodes every Thursday on YouTube. If you have any questions, please don't hesitate to contact us. We look forward to hearing from you.